hard times. Just an old friend, just an old friend to me. I said hard times, just an old friend, just an old friend to me. Tell me now, old friend, well, when you gonna let me be? Can't you feel the cold wind? It's howling down, blowing my soul. Can't you feel the cold wind? It's howling down, blowing my soul. Well, I ain't an old man, but you know my time ain't long. Gonna be a hard rain, hear it in the distance, sounds so near. Gonna be a hard rain, but you hear it in the distance, sounds so near. When the rain comes, it's gonna wash us all away from here.
My name is Richard Kemp, and I came here because I heard there was going to be some affordable housing being built 20-some-odd years ago. Initially, I didn't believe it. It was such a good deal that I didn't think it would happen. But I came, and I stayed, and I'm still here. I'm here because, for political reasons. In our society, which is a capitalist society that you all know about, people make money on selling things and doing things. So when you can make money on housing, you as a capitalist want to make as much money as you want. Here at this Flint Avenue Co-op, this is a cooperative. So nobody really makes any money because the people who live here set the rent. And that's magic. I mean, why should I want to increase my rent and somebody else get it? No money leaves this place. The money stays, any money, any profit we make stays here. And that's a very important concept for people who are low-income, moderate-income kinds of folks. And I think we need more of it. We got to have more of it.
Pensez-vous que Barack Obama connaît Flint Cop?
Well, I must admit, I haven't told him about it. But now that you've prompted me, he ought to know what we're doing, because it is a very important social function that we're providing housing for people. And as a rule of thumb, that if you're paying more than 30% of your income for housing, you're in trouble. And we have to really stop that process, because again, we live in a capitalist society and people are going to make money, but there has to be some effort on the part of government to help cooperatives operate and function and get funded and provide people with decent housing, affordable housing.
À partir de 2007, les banques d'affaires américaines distillent le poison des subprimes et autres fonds spéculatifs toxiques dits hedge funds. En réponse et au terme d'une période d'oubli de plus de 50 ans, la société civile américaine réinvente l'antidote et revisite la vieille idée de la coopération sociale venue de Grande-Bretagne à la fin du 19e siècle sous l'appellation de Community Land Trust, littéralement communauté, sol, confiance, ou fiducie foncière communautaire. Mais de quoi s'agit-il exactement? Les fiducies sont des organisations non spéculatives qui utilisent à la fois des fonds privés et publics afin de proposer des opportunités de logement abordables à des ménages à faible revenu. Les fiducies sont les représentantes d'un mouvement immobilier coopératif, équitable et démocratique. Les racines politiques des fiducies s'ancrent en effet dans le mouvement de la contestation radicale et pré-révolutionnaire chartiste de l'Angleterre du milieu du 19e siècle, dans les principes coopératifs inventés par les pionniers de Rochdale, de la banlieue de Manchester, et dans le concept visionnaire de cité-jardin imaginé par Ebenezer Howard. Afin d'illustrer notre propos, nous avons choisi de travailler sur deux sites urbains très disparates, mais également très complémentaires. Le premier, situé en milieu urbain dense, Cooper Square, à New York City, au cœur du quartier Lower East Side, lieu historique de l'immigration populaire et de la contestation politique radicale à New York. Le second, en site rural et de villégiature, à Burlington, État du Vermont. Donc Champlain Housing Trust, à Burlington, ville de 40 000 habitants dans l'État du Vermont, à la frontière du Québec, est une organisation pionnière au sein du mouvement des Community Land Trusts. L'organisation a vu le jour dans le courant des années 80, en réaction à la spéculation immobilière intense qui se déployait dans cette petite ville du nord rural des États-Unis, devenue lieu de villégiature de populations aisées en provenance de New York, Boston ou Montréal. Champlain Housing Trust est désormais à la tête d'un portefeuille immobilier de 2000 logements, d'une valeur de 250 millions de dollars, géré sous égide d'une fiducie foncière communautaire. Comment a débuté l'aventure du pionnier Champlain Housing Trust?
In the early 1980s, the city of Burlington, the citizens of the city of Burlington elected a progressive mayor, actually a socialist mayor, because the previous governments in the city had not addressed important housing issues, housing cost issues, the displacement of tenants. And so there was a great sort of groundswell of people wanting the city government to assist people to have good quality affordable housing. Our waterfront was being developed, and even with the new mayor developing the waterfront, not as had been past planned for condominiums and such for the rich, but as a community asset with public access to the waterfront, that was adding value, of course, to our downtown. And as a result, people were being displaced from our traditional neighborhoods. We'll see later the Old North End. The mayor created a community development office, and I was working in housing in that office, and we were looking for solutions so that we could improve those low-income neighborhoods and give, you know, quality to people without displacing people and to protect them. Also in the 1980s here, interest rates were in the double digits, so home ownership was out of reach. As land prices increased, and that was happening all over Vermont as our land gentrified, and you know, people from out of state were seeking our beautiful land for vacation homes and such. As a result of that, it was hard for people to become homeowners, and also renters were really fragile.
D'où venaient ces populations aisées?
New York, Boston, Montreal. And in our research, we came across this model called the Community Land Trust, which offered not only a solution to creating permanent affordability, but in keeping with the values of our government, it was a model that would be engage the citizens, and we could work with the citizens and, rather than just, you know, for the citizens. And so we looked into this model, and we offered it, you know, we did some education in the neighborhoods and in the community, and people really embraced this idea, and as we had expected, because of all the grassroots engagement we had been working with, it was neighborhood groups and tenant groups and all the people who were not served in the previous government. So instead of burning, we needed the citizens to be engaged, and we believed in that. So this model was perfect. What the Community Land Trust model offered us, in addition to it being an opportunity for citizens themselves to own the land collectively and you know, direct the development of their neighborhood, but also it allowed us to invest a lot on it with them because the homes would remain permanently affordable. And we were able then to cut into this gentrification and put a stop to it. On the homeownership side, this is where the greatest innovation really occurred from the Community Land Trust, because no one had figured out how to keep homeownership, really homeownership, but make it permanently affordable. And this model offered that option. So our Community Land Trust, we formed it really in what was the classic model we had learned about and we created a board of directors that would include one-third residents of the homes. We didn't have any yet, but and a third local government and a third public. So in this way, even though we were going to acquire land, this is organized as a nonprofit corporation, the ownership of the land was really on behalf of the community, and that made it more acceptable to people. And we began to raise money for this entity. The city government gave a seed grant of $200,000, which is not huge, but it got us started organizationally. And a local bank put forward some affordable capital for us. It was called the Burlington Savings Bank then, to acquire property. And the city put some of their pension funds so that we could acquire property with that capital. And we began to purchase what was mostly rental properties in Burlington's Old North End, which were going up for sale, you know, for speculative purposes. So we were sort of rescuing properties. And at the time, there was not a lot of capital to fit them up. But in time, we did a lot of rehab, and we kept the rents down.
Combien de propriétés sont ainsi sauvées de la spéculation?
First years, probably 100 units. Oui. The way it works in a trust is we own the land always, and we may own the building if we're going to rent it, or the residents can own the building. And we had hope that the residents of these buildings, we could help them to co-op and own the buildings collectively. We had to create legislation and get it passed for co-ops. But actually, once these folks had a social landlord, they were happy to not also have to operate. And then we're small, you know. But all of our residents were are members of the trust. And so they felt they have some corporate rights and they feel engaged. So that really, it got us in. We always thought these would all be cooperative. Everything would be ownership. But we left people with the choices they wanted. They didn't want to co-op. It was a very new idea here. It's a very urban model. Mm-hmm. And people here were like, no, you guys are doing this. It's good. And they didn't want to co-op. So we thought, well, we better learn to be good social landlords. We developed a model where we would own the land. The homeowner only had to buy the house. The homeowner could get a mortgage, have a ground lease with us, which was not at commercial rate. It was really just a lease. And in the lease is a resale formula that keeps, like in a shared, in a limited equity co-op, which keeps the property affordable sale after sale after sale. And no, when we took this idea out, people thought we were crazy. And we went to a state agency that made mortgages, and it took a lot of advocacy, but we convinced them that as their mission as a public lender, they should create the mortgage that could go on this lease. Because in this country, you never separated land and house in residential lending. So that was a big innovation, and once we overcame that and we started getting loans, we also got local banks to loan, and they saw it as a local thing they could do. And so that was a pioneering thing, and it took us a year and a half to buy the first home, and then it took us a couple of years to get a little project of 9 homes. But you know, today we have 530 homes. The other work we had to really do in the early days was, we mentioned early on how much the land values were increasing, and it turned out that across the state, tenants were being displaced. Being displaced even by housing that the government had subsidized with private developers, who then could sell it on. And so we advocated we built an advocacy in the city, and we passed some ordinances to protect residents from conversion and to create new funding sources. We created a city trust fund and an ordinance that required any builder to add affordable homes when they built higher priced homes, called inclusionary zoning. We passed ordinances also to protect tenants from condo conversions of their homes, to slow down this gentrification. But then we worked with advocates from around the state, and by 1987 we had created a state housing trust fund as well. And it's funded by a tax that actually taxes speculative value, as well as a statewide condo conversion ordinance, housing cooperative formation ordinance, and tenant protections. So this took the 80s, pretty much the decade, to get all these things in place, but that was quite quick for such a change.
My name is Jody Whalen, and I live here in Burlington, Vermont. I was born in Reading, Pennsylvania, United States, in 1967. I'm 46 years old. I lived with my mother, brother, two sisters, my grandparents, and my uncle in a very small house in a small town of 600 people. It was a blue-collar background. I got married when I was in my 20s. My first husband was a teacher, and I was working in marketing. Even though we worked hard, we didn't have enough money to buy a house. So we heard about the Champlain Housing Trust and took some classes on what it takes to afford a house. While we were taking the classes, we were living in an apartment here in Burlington. Rent in Burlington is very high. We learned through the class that a mortgage would actually be less expensive than the rent we were paying. With the help of Champlain Housing Trust, we were given a grant for the down payment on our house. So we bought our very first house through their assistance. After living in our house for a few years, it was time for us to move on and purchase a house on the open market. Because of the help from Champlain Housing Trust and our low mortgage, we were able to save enough money for a down payment. The next person to buy our Champlain Housing Trust house was in the same predicament that we had been in years ago. It was at the closing sale of the house where I had a very special moment in my life. Passing the keys to the house over to the new buyer brought me to tears because I knew that this woman would be given the opportunity, the life-changing opportunity that my husband and I had been given. It was very special to us. Unfortunately, after a few years, my first husband and I divorced, but I found myself as a single mother with two children in need of housing again. So I turned to the Champlain Housing Trust for the second time in my life. They helped me find a condominium that the three of us could live in. Again, it was very affordable. It was easy for us to get into, very low maintenance to the house, and it helped me get on my feet again. Again in my life, without them, I would have lived a risky existence because housing prices here in Burlington, Vermont are very high if you're a renter. So with their help, again, I had a new chapter of availability and prosperity in my future.
Les prix des logements ont-ils beaucoup augmenté dans l'intervalle?
Yes.
In between the two, your first CLT and...
Absolutely. Yeah. Not just apartment house prices, but also housing prices. My first home on the market was about $120,000, and that same home now would be probably $225,000, $250,000. And income hasn't gone up very much for people. At that time, I had been making more money in 1992 than I did in 1999. Income levels have not gone up the same as housing prices.
My name is John Olson. I have lived at the Flynn Avenue Housing Cooperative for about 12 years. I had known about housing co-ops for 5 or so years before I moved in here, but was able to move in as a roommate in about 2000 or 2002. And then I got my own unit in 2005 at a nice two-bedroom. We all have the opportunity and responsibility to participate actively in the co-op. To maintain the grounds and the buildings and our governance. And when I first moved here, I signed up to be on the grounds committee, so I took my turn mowing the lawn and shoveling snow, and then eventually ran for a seat on the board of directors. So after a couple years on the board of directors, I was nominated and elected to be the treasurer. And so I was one of the officers, and I managed the budgets and also the financial statements with the help of the Champlain Housing Trust. Living at in a cooperative housing is that it is affordable. I was a student when I moved in, and I only needed to come up with $3,000 as my ownership share, as opposed to a $10,000 down payment on a comparable condominium. And the affordability is very important to many of our residents. We have 28 units here. Most of them are two bedrooms, and many of the folks who live here have small children, and many are also single parents. So on one income, having an affordable way to get beautiful housing is very, very important.
Quel est le prix d'un logement abordable pour vous?
There's a lot of formulas that go into that, These units are affordable because our monthly charges for any household is about $975 a month, and many of the households have subsidies that make that less expensive for them. So that helps them live here, live in great housing, be in a nice community, and be active. You can see that we've got a playground, we've got a meeting room, and folks can take advantage and be fully involved without spending more of their monthly income than necessary. A comparable unit on the retail market for rental might be about $1,200 for a two-bedroom like these. I mentioned the number of families. We have about 40 people who live here. We have 20 children under the age of 20. That's the most we've had in some number of years. It's really quite wonderful. It's a very diverse community. We have folks of various races. We have gay and lesbian folks who live here. We have single families. We have young families. We have older folks. And we have roommate situations. It's a really great opportunity to have just a mix of people involved.
Est-ce que la population a beaucoup changé depuis les débuts de la coopérative?
One of the great things about this community is that folks have been here a long time. We have three founders who've been here for 22 years, and we have folks who have moved in the last year or so and brought new, vibrant energy. And the average length of time that people stick around is about 7 years. And that's really helped us with a sense of community and for the children to grow up with friends and to have playmates who grow as they grow. And it also is wonderful for the parents who can share babysitting and childcare responsibilities.
Comment s'applique ici la règle de la formule de la revente équitable?
When we first set up the co-op, we wanted people to realize some return on their investment. So while the original share costs were $2,000 20 years ago, those are now about $3,000 or $3,100, sort of in steady, based on inflation.
Et au bout de 7 années, quel est le retour autorisé pour les habitants?
There is no average on that. It really depends on how long you live here. Used to be that in your second year, you'd start earning credit toward the debt reduction, and that would build over time. So someone who's lived here a long time, like Marcia, will have quite a bit of credit built up. I'll have half of that because I've been here half as long. And someone who's been here only a few years will have very little credit. Actually, someone who moved in the last 3 years won't have any credit because we eliminated that calculation.
Meet a woman. Oh, people tell me, where can she be?
John Emmaus Davis, l'un des théoriciens du mouvement des fiducies aux États-Unis, par ailleurs très investi auprès du Champlain Housing Trust. John Emmaus Davis procède à une présentation théorique du modèle d'organisation politique de la fiducie. Il nous expose ce qui pourrait constituer, selon lui, un modèle idéal typique de fiducie foncière communautaire. Comment les fiducies s'organisent-elles face à la spéculation immobilière?
Well, I think that first, community land trusts take land off the speculative market, take housing and other structures that are built on the land off the speculative market. So the first way they address what's happening in a very hot real estate market is to insulate key parts of real estate against the up and the down of the market. Because when you think about speculation, most people only think about markets that are very hot, when prices are very high, and low-income people and moderate-income people being pushed out of neighborhoods because of a hot market. But what they forget is that capitalism has booms, it also has bust. So there's a cycle. And what we've learned, particularly since the collapse of our real estate market between 2006 and 2008, is that there's another side to the business cycle. And that's when prices collapse, when mortgages go bad, there has to be a safety net. So we need to protect low-income people, moderate-income people, when markets are hot, but there also has to be a safety net, a floor, when markets collapse. So in the world of community land trust, we talk about the three faces of stewardship. We preserve affordability, we protect the condition of the buildings on a land trust land, and we prevent foreclosures.
Précisément, le mouvement des fiducies permet-il aux gens, avec peu de revenus, d'inverser les termes de la domination imposée par le marché?
Most of our public policies, most of our public conversation about policy revolves around making markets more effective, making people who already have wealth and power have more. Community land trust, at their best, are not just about community ownership, they're also about community empowerment. Power is an aspect of this model. That is, we build a membership, we build a base of support, not only among people who benefit from the community land trust, not only the people who live in the housing of a community land trust, we build a broad community constituency for this alternative approach to ownership. You know, in the United States, most of our public policy around community development, around housing, is not at the federal level, it's at the municipal level. We give our city governments an enormous amount of power in determining how to spend money that may originate in Washington, but it comes down to the city level. See, and part of our appeal at the city level is a very conservative, very fiscally conservative argument. That is, that if you invest in a community land trust, if you invest in this kind of housing, you make the investment one time. This is a very prudent way to put public money into community development, because the money stays in the land, the money stays in the housing, and it doesn't leave the community, right? When the house resells, when people move out, they don't take that public investment and put it in their pockets and leave the community.
Qu'apportent les fiducies dans les pratiques de la démocratie?
So remember that the governing board of most community land trusts has three parts. You know, you have to think about kind of creating incubators of democracy. People have to learn how to make decisions together. We're not taught in our schools how to do democracy, how to make decisions in a group, how to deal with conflict. What the community land trust does is it draws people from the community and from the housing that we've developed, and puts those people with very different interests onto the same governing board. Most community land trust boards are structured with a diversity of interest, and people need to learn within that space, within that safe space, to make decisions, to fight fair, to compromise. And that's something that we don't learn and do very well in the United States.
Burlington compte 40 000 habitants. Tout le monde connaît tout le monde, Champlain Housing Trust peut parler au maire. Les gens peuvent se parler entre eux, mais comment faire si on change d'échelle, notamment dans les mégalopoles urbaines de plusieurs millions d'habitants, comme à New York? N'y a-t-il pas un risque de voir les membres des fiducies rester sur leur île et de ne se parler uniquement qu'entre eux?
Yeah, I do. It's a challenge.
Yeah.
Yes, yes. I mean, the question is always whether you're going to create an island where people on the island talk to each other versus are you going to extend beyond your enclave, beyond your island, to involve your neighbors in the same neighborhood and to involve, infect other neighborhoods. That's an issue that every community land trust faces in a small city like Burlington, in a large city like Boston or New York. First, you have to be effective inside your own island. You have to take care of business. People who live in the co-op on land trust land have to be happy with what's going on. Yes? So first, you have to pass the kitchen table test. What that means is that you have to be able to sit across the kitchen table from the people who are benefiting from the housing you've provided, and are they going to say yes? Are they going to say, this is effective, I'm glad I bought this house? That's the first test. I think you have to think of this almost like throwing a stone into a pond and the ripples go out. First, you have to serve the people in that inner circle who are in your housing on your land. The next ring are the people who live in the immediate neighborhood around your land, around your housing. The Community Land Trust has been very, very effective in the first and in the second. Only in a few cities has it also been effective in the larger ring of going out to adjacent neighborhoods, other neighborhoods, and affecting the city as a whole. I would point to Boston. I would point to Los Angeles. I would point to Duluth, Minnesota, and Burlington, Vermont.
Que se passe-t-il dans les villes américaines qui vivent un fort déclin industriel? Y a-t-il un mouvement de fiducie à Détroit, Cleveland ou Baltimore?
Yes, and some of the shrinking cities and some of the divested cities, there have been community land trusts. The role they play is different, yes? In a strong city with a strong market where gentrification and displacement and speculation are the principal problems, a community land trust becomes a bulwark against those kind of market pressures. In a city like Syracuse or Cleveland, Duluth, Minnesota, less so, but cities where you have weak markets, community land trusts tend to play the role of creating a market, creating demand, demonstrating that people will move into a neighborhood. So that's a very different role that they play in weak markets. A community land trust should not only do housing. Community ownership of land and community development itself has to be about more than housing. And I think community land trusts that have also looked at food, urban agriculture, jobs, schools, public safety, you have to remember that a community land trust principal asset is land. Anything you can build on land, anything you can do with land, can be done through a community land trust.
John Emmaus Davis estime donc que Champlain Housing Trust fait partie des quelques fiducies qui, aux États-Unis, sont parvenus à exercer une influence forte, non seulement sur le premier cercle de leurs membres, et sur celui du voisinage de proximité, mais aussi sur le marché immobilier de Burlington dans son ensemble. Mais en quoi cette parole fait-elle preuve? S'il est établi que la municipalité de Burlington a joué un rôle majeur pour le lancement de Champlain, pour autant, le marché immobilier et les spéculateurs locaux ont-ils été mis en échec ou simplement en tension en raison de la croissance de l'organisation pionnière? Burlington s'est-elle transformée, selon la formule de John Rawls, en une démocratie de propriétaires, c'est-à-dire en un système équitable de coopération entre citoyens libres et égaux, d'une génération à la suivante, où ont été placés entre les mains des citoyens en général, et non pas seulement de quelques-uns, des moyens productifs suffisants pour qu'ils soient des membres pleinement coopérants de la société sur une base d'égalité. Nous avons donc souhaité confronter cette vision du monde et le modèle idéal typique de fiducie présenté par John Emmaüs Davis à la situation de jeunes et moins jeunes américains qui vivent très directement l'absence de logements abordables sur Burlington, les saisies immobilières, les politiques de bas salaire pratiquées de nos jours dans le Vermont et aux États-Unis. Populations qui, en d'autres termes, sont confrontées à l'instinct prédateur du marché, selon la formule de Thorsten Veblen, et qui méritent également d'être entendues.
I'm Belinda. I'm originally from Bronx, New York. I lived the first 18 years of my life in New York City. I went to grade school in the Bronx and eventually to high school in Manhattan and at a public performing arts school. Much of my life back home was involved with the arts, theater, dancing, writing was a big part of my life. It was something healthy to do. In my neighborhood, usually there wasn't too much to do. Sometimes it had to do with safety, and I wasn't interested in really just hanging out on the street. So I found other ways to accommodate my interests.
Est-ce que cela a été facile de trouver une maison à Burlington?
No, in the beginning, I was sleeping on a floor for 4 months with my friend Darshana. Yeah, we had a roof, but no bed. I tried to avoid sleeping outside if I could. So that was the beginning of a long life of couch surfing. Staying temporarily with people here and there, sometimes paying rent, sometimes bartering, sometimes feeling safe, sometimes not feeling so safe.
Votre travail correspond à votre formation?
No. I never thought I would be serving coffee for a living. I studied film and lots of dance. Eventually wanting to teach. I think most of the time I've lived in Burlington, I've never really rented a place more than a few months, which then made it more difficult for me to rent an apartment or a room for a year because I had no solid references from landlords.
Avez-vous fini par trouver un logement sur Burlington, notamment avec l'aide de Champlain Housing Trust?
Last year was when I reached out to them in full, Champlain Housing Trust, and they had a lot of cooperatives I wanted to move into, but they didn't have availability, so I was on a waiting list. I applied for other homes that were available on their list, but one of the biggest conflicts was cost, location, and I also have a cat. Which does not make housing any easier to find. And if you do find a place that is willing to take the cat in, the costs go up for liability reasons.
Vous pouvez nous donner une idée du prix de votre logement?
If the landlord is nice and open-minded, he might only charge an extra $25 or $50 in the deposit. But there was one apartment I really wanted. It was $950, the deposit was $950, and for the cat, she wanted to charge me an extra $500 in deposit and an extra $200 per month.
Ce prix, c'était sur le marché privé. Ce n'est pas avec Champlain.
That was through the Housing Resource Center, which is, I mean, there are certain organizations that still do work together. So I was referred to the Housing Resource Center by Champlain, and that's where I discovered that a different list and followed up on that list.
Vous avez eu d'autres expériences avec Champlain?
I found my experience with them was that they were more of a bridge between myself and available housing opportunities. It was sort of like matching my profile to the availability of certain homes, but it still came down to me following up. And Champlain Housing Center, they have their guidelines, but then when they give your information to the available housing on their list, those homes have their own guidelines. So it's like having to walk through two different doors.
Finalement, comment avez-vous trouvé votre logement?
When I finally found the home I'm currently living in, it was actually through Craigslist, the internet, which can always be a gamble and you never know who you're going to meet. But it ended up being such a beautiful home, and I received a call back from the woman who's now one of my roommates. And I'm very, very happy with where I live.
Quel est son prix?
So I live with two women in a two-story Victorian house, and I pay $600 a month. Utilities aren't more than $100, so $700 altogether. And my cat was allowed with no extra cost involved.
Quel est votre salaire net?
About $1,200. A month. Between the bakery, I do a lot of nude modeling for art classes, which is how I make a lot of extra money. And I teach dance classes as well, which is what I'm very passionate about. So it's not always easy, but I get to live in a beautiful home where I'm happy and do things that make me happy, while still having a stable part-time job that I enjoy very much.
Pour un mi-temps théorique de 23 heures par semaine, mais de 30 heures de travail effectif, le salaire horaire de Belinda est d'environ $9.50, ce qui représente, dans le secteur des services, un salaire net mensuel de $874. Une fois que l'on aura ajouté $276 de pourboire mensuel, soit $3 de l'heure, indispensable pour lui permettre de survivre, on arrive à un salaire moyen mensuel de $1,150 environ. Où sommes-nous ici?
A community center. We're open every day or during weekdays for anyone to come in and just hang out here. We have snacks that people eat. We have one of our staff helps people find jobs. We have free computers for people to use, and we hold a bunch of different events, groups, and activities. We have 3 full-time staff and about 10 people part-time. Pathways Vermont is the big organization. We are one program of it. And our funding comes from the State of Vermont Department of Mental Health.
Est-ce que vous pouvez vous présenter?
My name is Alexander Ferguson. I moved to Burlington about a year and a half ago. I currently work for the Wellness Co-op part-time. And I've been... I traveled across the country for a while and was homeless for a while. And when I had moved to Burlington, I found an apartment, and it was difficult finding an apartment for sure. And I had looked to the Wellness Co-op for resources and finding a job. And so I came here to work on my resume and to try and make some connections in the community.
Vous avez trouvé un logement?
Yeah, I found an apartment in the North End, and it feels good. It feels good. It's the first time in my life that I've been in one place for like a year and stable.
C'est du logement privé, social?
It's private. It's
private?
Yeah, yeah.
No social housing.
Quel est votre loyer?
I pay close to 600 right now. It's expensive. Cheap for Burlington, though.
Et avec les charges?
It's about 100. It comes out to sometimes more, 120. Sometimes it rounds off to.
My name is Nick Parrish, and I work as the project director here at the Wellness Co-op. I grew up in southern Vermont and moved to Burlington in 2002. I was actually working as a social worker for Pathways to Housing Vermont when they first opened in Burlington for 3 years. Thank goodness I do not have any direct experience with being homeless, but I do have experience with the housing market in Burlington, having rented here for many years and having recently purchased a house here in the Old North End.
On nous a parlé d'une personne qui est propriétaire de 85 maisons sur le quartier de North End. Ce sont des maisons très colorées. Qu'est-ce que vous pensez d'une situation où un propriétaire peut, sur tout un quartier, être maître du marché dans une petite ville comme Burlington?
Yes, my partner and I bought a house last summer, and the housing market in Vermont, even though it didn't become as bad as the rest of the country in the economic collapse and recently, even when it was bad, it was still hard to find affordable houses to buy or to rent because there's only four or five landlords that own most of the houses in the city. And the person you mentioned is one of the smaller ones. The big landowners buy every house that comes on the market. It's really hard for people, especially with a lower income, such as myself, to be able to purchase a house, even though in theory we can afford a small mortgage, unless you get into a contract really quickly, discover the house and get into contract really quickly, they're off the market and they'll become rental housing and we'll all be priced out.
Qui est le propriétaire de votre local? Combien payez-vous de loyer?
Champlain.
Oh, housing trust. Owner. Owner.
We
much,
rent.
How much did they rent to you, to your association?
We're in an agreement that since we've started renting here in December, we pay, I think, $1,400 a month in rent, not including utilities, with the expectation that we are going to purchase this building from them. And if we purchase it before July, then that'll be good. If we can't get the money before then the rent is going up to around $2,000 in July.
Est-ce que Champlain Housing Trust vous aide? Ou bien est-ce juste un propriétaire?
They helped us with this. I think they gave us a good deal with this building. We don't have much relationship with them, except sometimes they have units that they rent to people for cheap.
Il y a une photo de Martin Luther King derrière vous. Alors, avez-vous un rêve?
My dream for like my life just goes throughout long run, just about with all other sorts of things and people. And all those sorts of stuff going on throughout the years. You know, I'm only 19, and like, I've been living with my mom my whole life, and I don't know what's gonna happen from here on out. My dream is just to kind of start my own community, and to change the world positively.
I'm looking for self-sufficiency and to become more independent. To to one day maybe have my own house, my mm-hmm. own garden, and work towards being more sufficient in general, so that I don't need to depend on some big slumlord or even so much the grocery store for my food. I'd like to grow my own food and have my own resources.
I think some of my dreams have already come true. I have a great job, and I own a house. Well, part of a house. But I think that as far as the organization that I work for, I think because our state is so small, we have a real chance to end homelessness in Vermont. And if the government does its job and puts money into programming that acknowledges that housing is a human right for everybody.
Est-ce que vous savez ce qu'est une fiducie foncière communautaire?
Champlain Housing Trust or
Land Trust?
Land Trust.
Mm-hmm. I don't know.
I'm familiar somewhat with their like ideas, but I have not gotten housing through them before. I've kind of slipped beneath the cracks and found ways to stay places, houses that are individually owned. So I rent from the individual rather than go through some of the system that's in Burlington. And I kind of stay off the grid that way because it can be expensive, I think, dealing with landlords. But with the housing trust, with the land trust, what specifically do you mean by that?
I've lived in land trust cooperative housing, and I have looked to buy through the land trust. We didn't find something that we wanted.
Okay.
And we were able to buy something outside of that system that was still affordable. And I think that it is a decent model, but is only one small part of providing housing to people who need housing. I think that for people with steady working class or middle income families, then it is a good option. But we don't live in an economy where there are very many steady working class jobs anymore, and so a lot of people cannot afford to get housing even through the land trust.
L'offre disponible effective de logements abordables dont dispose Champlain Housing Trust sur Burlington se limite à ce jour à environ 10 à 15 offres de logements par mois. Dans le même temps, sa liste d'attente est de l'ordre de 200 demandes par mois, ce qui représente un taux de satisfaction extrêmement réduit de 5% environ. Face aux limites de son offre locative effective de logements abordables, Champlain Housing Trust a choisi de repositionner son action dans le champ de l'hébergement. Ainsi, Champlain rachète pour 1,8 million de dollars et remet en service fin 2013 Arbor Place, un vieux motel d'environ 30 places situé Shelburne Road, à 8 miles du centre-ville de Burlington. Cette initiative des pionniers constitue un tournant dans sa stratégie face au marché tout-puissant et entre par nature en contradiction avec l'essence de ce que propose être une fiducie foncière communautaire, c'est-à-dire un ensemble humain, coopératif, équitable et démocratique, dans lequel chaque membre fait partie intégrante de la communauté. Comment un sans domicile fixe serait-il en effet en mesure d'acquérir le statut de membre à part entière de la communauté du Champlain au terme d'un délai de 28 jours, durée de séjour maximale autorisée à Arbor Place? Nous avons souhaité rencontrer les résidents d'Arbor Place. La direction de Champlain ne nous y a pas autorisés. Interdiction bien dérisoire au regard des nombreux sans-abri que l'on peut croiser à Burlington. Nous avons donc échangé avec Israël, SDF et citoyens américains. Témoignage.
My name is Israel. I came up here from Connecticut in 1980, and I started living outside as a homeless person, camping out in tents. And in those days, there was a lot of reasonably priced housing, cheap. There were quite a few homeless people up here who didn't want to live inside. They came up here in the summer to camp out. Most of them were drinkers, alcoholics, and they lived outside in the summer, and in the winter they'd go other places. I used to live outside in the summer, and then in the wintertime I'd go to Florida or California or Arizona to camp because I liked living outside. And I've been doing that since 1980. Right now, I'm living in my pickup truck. I have a pickup truck with a cap, and I'm camping in my pickup truck. And we'll probably go back into the woods maybe sometime this week or next week. I like living outside in the woods.
Pensez-vous qu'il y a davantage de sans-abri aujourd'hui sur Burlington que dans les années 80?
Well, I'm not exactly sure. Probably less, because in those days it was okay. Police did not bother people. They mostly lived down by the lake at the waterfront, which in those days was a freight yard. Now it's a park, so the police don't want homeless people living down there anymore. So they chase the homeless out. I was camping when I first got back here in about a month ago. I put my tent in the woods, and the police came and burnt my tent. So I said, okay, well, I'll move into my truck. So I've been living in my truck since then. Well, I don't know. It's getting harder to be a homeless person up here. The police have closed off. There used to be a lot of places where homeless people could get into a little situation, and it was okay. The police were not chasing people then. Now they go after the homeless people and they say, move, go. And it's harder now.
Vous avez entendu parler d'Harbor Place?
And what's that?
Harbor Place,
yeah.
What do you think about that?
I hear it's a motel that was converted into
outside
some...
outside of the city, yeah.
Some kind of housing. One fellow lived down there and he said it was horrible, the room was terrible, it was moldy, and I've never seen it myself, but he didn't like it.
Qu'est-ce que vous pensez de Burlington?
It's nice. The weather is nice in the summertime, and the lake, you go swimming in the lake, and there were plenty of good times up here then. Now it's not so good.
Il y avait auparavant des communautés hippies?
Yeah, there was a lot of young hippies then that were, you know, having a good time, you know, but now it's too crowded now, too many tourists.
Like fashion or
it's the rich, like, the rich people are taking over Burlington and pushing the poor people out. That's happening everywhere.
Vous savez pourquoi?
Gentrification.
Gentrification.
Plus, it's very nice to live up here, you know, compared to a lot of places in America. The weather and the scenery and skiing and hiking and camping and boating. When I came up here in 1980, there were like a few boats on the lake, not too many. Now you got a lot of boats, sailboats. People come down from Montreal and they live on their sailboats in the summertime. It's big. It's a big tourist place in Burlington now. All the big hotels.
En le quittant, nous avons souhaité bonne chance à Israël. Il nous a répondu qu'il connaissait encore pas mal d'endroits dans les bois que la police ne connaît pas. Depuis 2007, avec l'explosion de la bulle spéculative liée au subprime, la banqueroute des banques américaines qui s'en est suivie, la multiplication des saisies immobilières et leurs conséquences sur le marché du travail, avec ses cohortes de sans-abri, de chômeurs et de travailleurs pauvres, l'impact du pionnier Champlain sur le marché immobilier de Burlington, loin de s'accroître, s'est fortement amenuisé. Au-delà de sa réussite patrimoniale des décennies 80-90, tout se passe désormais comme si, depuis les années 2000, le marché était parvenu à neutraliser Champlain Housing Trust au sein d'un périmètre de compétences aux frontières bien dessinées, celui des petits accédants à la propriété de la classe moyenne américaine. Au final, 30 ans après sa création, malgré le discours de ses dirigeants qui apparaît fortement décalé, l'action conduite par Champlain se révèle en réalité peu dommageable pour les intérêts immobiliers dominants sur Burlington. Ces derniers ne s'avèrent pas spécialement mis en échec, ni même en tension. Les upper classes et les key workers ont été renvoyés en direction du marché, ce qui est assez logique, mais les working class, c'est-à-dire les travailleurs pauvres, les chômeurs et les précaires nombreux sur Burlington également, ce qui l'est déjà beaucoup moins. Alors le marché ne connaît-il pas d'adversaire à sa mesure? La partie est-elle déjà jouée et perdue? Des éléments de réponse complémentaires et inattendus vont nous être fournis à l'occasion de notre seconde étape d'investigation, le Cooper Square Community Land Trust à New York City.
My name is Valerio Orselli. I'm the executive director of Cooper Square Mutual Housing Association, which is an innovative project on the Lower East Side of Manhattan. I'm not sure if you know very much about Lower East Side history, but the Lower East Side is a very unique community. You know, people talk about the founding of America and coming to Plymouth Rock, you know, and the Pilgrim Fathers, but only maybe 200 or 300 people came to America by way of Plymouth Rock in Massachusetts. But like I said, but in reality, very few people came to America by way of Plymouth Rock in Massachusetts. But more than one half of the United States population can trace their origins back to the Lower East Side, this neighborhood. There were reasons why this happened. One, because this community has always been tolerant. You know, people came to escape persecution from Europe, different countries there, religious, political persecution. They came to start a better economic life. They didn't stay necessarily in the Lower East Side. They went elsewhere, but they first came here. And the other important reason why they came here is affordable housing. The Lower East Side was never anything but a working class community from its very origins, okay? It developed because of the different people that came to this community, we created not what they call in sociological terms a melting pot. No, the community did not melt, but rather it became a community of many cultures. And also, because of the people that came, a very politically aware and active population. So in that sense, we were blessed politically, culturally, okay? Many creative people made their home on the Lower East Side, again, because of the affordable housing. We were also cursed. And we were cursed because the Lower East Side, if you look at a map of Lower Manhattan, you see on the south end, you have Battery Park City, Wall Street, high-rise buildings. And in Midtown, you have Madison Avenue, you know, advertising, high-rise buildings. In the middle, there's like nothing, because all the buildings we have here are largely low-rise. A perfect place for what they call in America a bedroom community for people who work on Wall Street or people who work in Midtown. But in the 1950s, things started to change. Robert Moses, who was a master planner, who is written up all over the place for all the projects he built, proposed a plan for the Cooper Square area that would have demolished all the buildings from Delancey Street to 9th Street, from 1st Avenue to 3rd Avenue. And his plans did not call simply for demolishing buildings, but removing the population that was overwhelmingly working class and poor. And that is how the Cooper Square Committee, our parent organization, was founded to oppose the Robert Moses plan. And they ultimately defeated the Moses plan. And they proposed an alternate plan for this area that would make the residents beneficiaries and not the victims of urban renewal. I'm condensing a lot of history in a very few words. We got the Cooper Square Committee won approval for their alternate plan, and some housing was built on the north and the south side of Houston Street for working class families. But By 1985, there was no more money for new construction, low-income housing. So what we had to do is we had to revise the plan and convince the mayor to support our vision, which was he wanted, Mayor Koch, he wanted market rate housing in this neighborhood. He wanted to do what he calls economic integration, okay? Which we said we are fine with that if you're gonna provide market rate housing here, but low income housing on the Upper East Side, which is a very bourgeois section of town. He didn't go for that. And we were stuck with 20 or more buildings occupied by low-income families and homeless people with no prospects of any new money for new construction. So we had to switch gears, and we made a deal with the city. And the deal was we would let the mayor build largely market-rate housing on two vacant lots on the north and south side of Houston Street in exchange for 25% of the units being low-income units and sufficient funding to renovate all the buildings that were occupied on 3rd Street and 4th Street in this neighborhood. And we did not want housing to be affordable for 10 years or 20 years and then it's no longer affordable. We wanted housing that was permanently affordable. So that's when we came up with the idea through meetings with our community. More than 40 different meetings were held, you know, community-wide, of a mutual housing association. The benefits of mutual housing association is we took buildings that were separate. They were on 3rd Street and 4th Street and 2nd Avenue, and we brought them together into a single cooperative structure, creating what they call, I think, in academic circles, an economy of scale, which meant that, using the original example of a building needs a new boiler, the money to replace the boiler did not come from the 15 tenants in the building. It came from the 400 tenants that make up the Mutual Housing Association. And that also meant that we can purchase fuel at a guaranteed price above wholesale, insurance, goods and services, and that we can charge the tenants what we call a de-economic rent, what's needed to maintain their apartment, plus a little extra that goes into the reserve fund. It also means some buildings have commercial space and some buildings do not. And generally the buildings in commercial space do better than the ones without commercial space. The income from our commercial space is shared by all the buildings, not just the building that have commercial space.
Au cours des années 90, Cooper Square réhabilite 22 immeubles. De son côté, la ville de New York City transfère à l'organisation la propriété de 25 immeubles, dont 399 appartements, 14 lofts et 25 locaux commerciaux.
Now there was another problem that we were concerned about. That the economy of scale helped to keep the housing affordable. But there's also the problem, because this is a gentrifying neighborhood, of preventing speculation. Okay? We rent, or we charge a tenant here, say, $400 a month for a one bedroom. Right next door, they charge $4,000 a month in a non-MHA building. Apartments in other cooperatives were sold, as they say in America, under the table. Okay? For $500,000 or $1 million or more, okay? And we wanted to prevent that. I own a cooperative apartment, let me say, okay? And there's a regulatory agreement that says I can't make a profit, or I can only make a limited profit on my apartment. But I make a deal with you, you give me $500,000, you get my apartment. So how do we do that? Well, what we did is we separated ownership of the buildings from ownership of the land, so that the Mutual Housing Association owns the buildings, but the Cooper Square Community Land Trust owns the land and leases it to the Mutual Housing Association, a 99-year lease. So the day that I want to sell my apartment to you for $500,000, if you are prudent, the first thing you're going to want is what they call clear title, meaning proof that I can sell it to you, okay? And you're going to find out that that can't be.
Now, if a member wants to be a member of the, if a person wants to be a member of the co-op at Cooper Square, it costs $1,800, which they pay to the co-op. And when they leave, when they move out, they will get that amount back plus whatever interest that has accumulated. However, they will never make a profit on that. It remains only $1,800 until they move out. And we call that limited equity cooperative. That is, you put your money into it, you put a little bit of your money, but you get the same amount of money back and you can't make a profit. Compare that to a private co-op or a private building, a condominium in New York City of the same size, and it will probably cost $1.8 million. So that gives you an idea how affordable this housing really is. The other thing I wanted to mention is that as a member of the board of Cooper Square Community Land Trust, one of the things that is that we are very much aware of is how all of the people who live in the housing are constantly living in the United States, where people's notion of housing is as a commodity to make a profit on. And so people, when they move in, have to really have a hard time understanding this idea that they're not going to make a profit on the housing. It's not the American dream. And so some people actually, some individuals, and this is a very, very small minority, actually resent the fact that they can't make a profit and would love to see it go back into the real estate market, because they would make an awful lot of money. If they, that $1,800 could be $1.8 million, they would be very happy. But most tenants, I think, really appreciate that their monthly housing costs are very low, among the lowest you can find anywhere in New York City. And so with the money that people are saving, you hear tenants say, well, I could send my children to college, and we could go on a vacation, which a lot of poor people in New York City cannot say, and they cannot do. They don't have the money, because over 50% of tenants in New York City are what we call rent burdened. That is, they're spending more than 30% of their gross income on housing. So the more they spend on housing, the less they have to spend on other things. People living in Cooper Square CLT properties are not rent burdened. So they can take rent off of the list of problems in their lives.
You don't have to tell me, I know every reason why you feel the way you feel, and you cry when you cry. But baby, can you show me how I get so far behind, from the bottom of your heart to the back of your mind? 'Cause sometimes I love you too much, sometimes I love you too much, sometimes I love you too much. But it's too late now, 'cause we're all going down. We're all going down. We're all going down. We're all going down.
Qui a pris cette décision de devenir une coopérative intégrale? le bureau ou les membres de la coopérative.
Before we had owners or renters, before the building were even renovated, we had membership meetings where many people attended, 100, 200 people at a time. And they looked at different models, including the other models that the city had. And they said, we want to go with this. We want to keep the housing affordable. So what makes this unique is, for example, the MHA cooperative has a board of 15. 10 of those 15 are shareholders, actionists. But 5 are appointed by the community land trust, and they cannot reside in the buildings. They must be outside people. And their role is to monitor and to help guide the Mutual Housing Association.
Quelles sont les perspectives pour Cooper Square dans la ville de New York?
The idea behind the Mutual Housing Association is that it is able to bring in more buildings so it could expand. And by expanding, it increases the economy of scale, although expansion has to make sense financially and politically. Okay. We believe that this model can be and has been replicated. Like there is a San Francisco Community Land Trust that's now functioning that borrowed our ideas. There's an initiative in East Harlem, sponsored by Picture the Homeless, that is following very closely the model that I delineated. But for us to really succeed, we need to almost have a cultural change. Because the culture of the city, New York City is run by a few industries. They call them FIRE, finance, insurance, real estate. They control the politics of the city. And the culture says, we're going to provide housing for poor people, but we're going to bring them out of poverty by giving them a chance to sell their apartment for a good deal of money so they can, you know, improve their economic life. We like to expand the idea of equity to be not just financial return on your cooperative, but in the form of providing an affordable housing to a low-income family allows them to get a better education, better training, to raise their children in a financially viable environment because the housing is affordable. And by doing so, improving the economic situation of working class and poor people without having to use speculation and without losing affordable housing. As I mentioned at the beginning of our conversation, this community has been economically poor, but culturally rich. We have people that came here dirt poor and they became a movie star. Or they became professionals or social workers, okay? Because they had affordable housing. Those benefits are not factored in, you know, in the city's political decision making.
My family is Venezuelan. I was born here.
Yeah. But your family is from?
My father came here in 1915 from Maracaibo. Uh-huh. My mother came here in 1917 from Caracas. I graduated high school, but I never went to college. My father usually worked in an office that did bills of ladings and documents like that for people who were shipping things out. He never made much money. And when I left school, I just got a job right away in a Franklin Simons, which was a clothing store. That's it. And so I went from small jobs to small jobs. I've been here about 12 years. And we came, I was in a building about on 3rd Street. And that building was owned by the city of New York. And the city of New York wanted to get rid of the building. But what they were proposing was going to create really bad problems for the tenants in that building. They were going to propose the tenant's interim lease, which means that a tenant could sell their apartments whenever they wanted to, which meant if that happened, that would have been the end of that building. Steve Herrick, who's head of the Cooper Square Committee, of which I'm a member also, I'm a member of Cooper Square Committee, he came to our building one day and told us about Cooper Square MHA, Mutual Housing Association. And for us, it was fantastic. It was wonderful that each one of us, each tenant, you know, owned a part of the association. And this was really low rent. And I couldn't believe that it was going to happen, and it happened. So we had a big struggle there with a number of the tenants, and but we convinced them to come here. It took us 4 years, that building there, to come here. We had to fight the city as well as fight certain tenants who wanted to make money, not guarantee themselves a good apartment. For example, this apartment costs, I think it's $400 a month with that and there. And I pay even less because I'm on Section 8. So I pay $160 a month for this apartment with a nice backyard. Everything I need. Ever since I've been here, I've been absolutely convinced that this method for people, especially for workers who don't earn much money, this type of setup should be throughout New York State. It should be throughout the United States. Anybody who says that there can't be low income housing in it, don't understand what's happening here. As a shareholder, I can participate to a certain extent in first electing members of the board, which is very important. Because unfortunately, now we have a few people who should never have been elected. But these things happen. People have to realize that you have to struggle constantly because there's 21 buildings and the real estate people would love to get a hold of these 21 buildings and make money. So we have to protect it. We have to defend it. Out of 300, there's going to be some who are also looking for money. So we have to be constantly fighting and protecting the organization so that it won't, we won't allow it to disappear.
I'm Joel Solonik. I'm a 60-something-year-old male who just went on Social Security, and I live on East 4th Street in the East Village, and the MHA is my landlord, and I'm very happy to have this apartment.
Quel était votre métier?
I was a car salesman. I sold automobiles.
Comment avez-vous connu Cooper Square?
Well, 30-some-odd years ago, or 30 years ago, my wife was involved in the organization of this organization. She was a community organizer, and they put together this Cooper Square to ensure that people of modest incomes would be able to house their families and not spend an enormous amount of money on rent. At the time, I'm sure New York City was very expensive to live in. It is today, but then even more so.
Quel est votre statut à Cooper Square?
I have an apartment right across the street. It's a small one bedroom, but it's very reasonably priced, only $550. And
a month.
And well, it's not really rent, it's monthly maintenance. It's monthly maintenance.
Okay.
Technically, I own the apartment, even though I can't sell it. I have to, when I want to leave, I have to turn it back over to the corporation, which is a non-profit.
Vous louez?
Well, like I said, technically I'm the owner. It's a co-op. But I can't sell it for a profit. I can only give it back to the corporation.
À quel prix avez-vous acheté votre appartement?
Same rent.
$550. So it wasn't rent. It wasn't a...
It was rent then. Now it's called monthly maintenance because the group owns all these buildings.
Qu'est-ce que vous pensez d'une telle formule à New York City, ville de la spéculation immobilière?
This is a good organization. It's a good idea. It would be nice if this building went co-op and I could sell it at a profit someday personally. But otherwise, when I'm finished with it and I have getting good service from these people and paying a reasonable rent, that when I'm finished, the next person or family can move in here and have the advantages, it's a wonderful thing. And it's very socialistic. It's a shame it's not more of these things around. Technically, I'm a communist. Well, communism isn't bad, just dictatorships are bad.
Vous voulez ajouter quelque chose?
All right, I'd like to say what I said before, that programs like this are very rare in the United States, certainly in New York City, and it's a shame there aren't more of them out there. You know, there's a lot of people who are free thinkers in this town, but they're not in charge, and they're not making policy in any way. It's hard to get things like this going, and the further we get into history, this was developed years ago, and they stayed on track. It's harder today than was then. Thank God they're still around today. I'm a big fan of Cooper Square. And I want to thank you guys for giving me the opportunity to say that. Thank you very much. My man, thank you.
Cooper Square Community Land Trust and the MHA do not exist as an island, and they never have. The Cooper Square Committee, which is a separate, larger organization, is a housing advocacy group. Cooper Square Committee is part of a very large collection of tenant and community organizations that have been fighting forever for better rent regulations, for more low-income housing, to preserve the existing low-income housing, to stop and slow gentrification. And it has been a constant struggle. One of the things I would like to see is more community land trusts in New York City. But that's not a matter of just snapping your fingers and going out and creating a land trust. It has to come out of more struggle. And right now, our movements are in a defensive phase, because the assault over the last 20 years by real estate capital has been absolutely aggressive. And we are on the defensive as a movement. We're on the defensive trying to save what we have. At the same time, government, including historical liberal and left elements in government, have thoroughly adopted the neoliberal economic policies, which say that basically our future lies in private development, from private real estate development. So if you want low-income housing, you have to get luxury housing at the same time. And that has been a disaster. And it has confused a lot of housing advocates.
L'idée coopérative, regardée par les hommes d'État comme une terrible forme de combinaison politique, par les riches comme un plan de spoliation, dénoncé en plein Parlement par les économistes politiques, ayant contre elle la presse et l'Église, cette idée, opposée à celle de compétition et de concurrence, a eu beaucoup à lutter et doit lutter encore pour pénétrer dans le commerce et l'industrie. L'opinion prévalait non seulement à Rochdale, mais d'un bout à l'autre du pays, que la coopération était une illusion et que les pauvres gens à donner à la nouvelle entreprise ne pouvaient être que de dangereux émissaires de quelques conspirations révolutionnaires, des espèces de fanatiques qui couraient à leur propre ruine, étant trop ignorants pour comprendre leur folie et leur danger. Searching for the ghost of time travel. He pulls a prayer book out of his sleeping bag. Preacher lights up a butt and takes a drag. Waiting for when the last shall be first and the first shall be last. In a cardboard box near the underpass. Got a one-way ticket to the promised land. Hole in your belly and a gun in your hand. Sleeping on a pillow of solid rock. Bathing in the city aqueduct. The highway is alive tonight. Where it's headed, everybody knows. I'm sitting down here. Waiting on the ghost of time travel. Tom said, Mom, wherever there's a cop beating a guy, wherever a hungry newborn baby cries, fight against the blood and hatred in the air. Look for me, Mom, I'll be there. Where there's somebody fighting for a place to stay. A decent job or a helping hand. Where somebody struggling to